24th birthday of Patrice Lumumba with us. It's a weekday, and I know you're probably all coming from work. So thank you for taking the time to be here. And I hope you're going to enjoy the program that we put together. This event is brought to you by the Friends of Congo, Congo Love, and Tabilulu Production. So we're going to celebrate his life through dancing and drumming. We're going to have a short film named The Memories of Lumumba. And then we're going to follow that by a discussion with Lumumba scholars that are based in Congo, Kinshasa. And then we're also going to have a special guest speaker and Lubangi that's going to moderate the talk. And then we're going to follow that by a music performance by Nkossi Konda, followed by a small reception with food. So we're going to start off the evening with the drumming and the dancing with Rahema and Andosh.
Thank you. honored to be here for this occasion, for the great, late Patrice Lumumba, this young, powerful man that stood up against so much at that time. When it comes to the dancing and the drumming, though, from Africa, it's a very communal thing. So it's not like an opera where you go and you sit, and when they finish, you're like that. So I really need to feel you moving, rocking, clapping, making sound, whatever you, you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Tommy Toss.
So, while he's telling people, I just want to share with you. So, how many of you are familiar with the Afrobeat, the popular Afrobeat movement right now? Okay. So, how many of you were familiar with soukous prior to the Afrobeat music? Okay. So, some people don't even know about soukous. But soukous is the base of all of the Afro music, music and the dance, okay? And soukous come out of Congo, right? So when you have time, look it up, share it with especially the young people. Share with them some of the sounds coming out of the Congo to re-familiarize them.
Sorry, are we following you?
Yeah.
Okay.
Zebula. Thank you. twice. But, yes, ma'am.
Well, I wanted to know, was that ceremonial dance? And is there dance in the Congo like they have in, for like the Yoruba, for the Orishas, that call forth the gods? I'm waiting for somebody to come down.
They were here. They were here. So that's a very super, super good question. And as a matter of fact, we were just dialoguing about what to do next, and there was one particular one I wanted to present. But what is really critical, and we had this at the presentation in October for Congo Week, the sister Sheila Walker came down, who's done a lot of research on Congo presence in the Americas. Uh-huh. So what you find is like the Orisha practices, the Yoruba practices, are actually laid on top of Congo spiritual practices. So it was the Congolese that came first and that were brought first. And the Congolese came not only with their own indigenous spiritual practices and culture, but they also came with a Catholicism that had been shifted to fit their culture. So when you see like in New Orleans and Brazil and places where people have Catholicism and they've actually changed the saints and made them to fit their own belief, a lot of it was that the Congolese already, because they've been indoctrinated with Catholicism in Congo before they were actually brought over, but they had already did transitions with Catholicism, you know, to the point where the Europeans had killed certain leaders who had taken Catholicism and made it their own. Like, no, this is the way it's supposed to be, right? So when you see even some of the words, like she introduced to us the idea that Macumba and Candomblé in Brazil, both of those are Congolese words.
Oh, really?
Even though they're practicing what we know as Yoruba practices, and they speak Yoruba language during their rituals and stuff.
And the same for me is the derivation.
The same. So just Cuba, Haiti, Congo was first. Congolese came first. And that in the lower south of the Americas, the same. So
it's still practiced, and how is it referred to?
I don't understand the question.
Well, yeah, they say Yoruba, they say Santeria.
Right. It's not as acknowledged, the Congo presence, because the Congolese came earlier, and then after them, people were brought from Western Africa, and people were brought with those practices. And so it's laden on top. So some people don't even we just don't realize it. We don't know our own history. But there was also a sister that did the study I met out of University of Texas, the same thing. She found things throughout the South on burials and different things that people were doing were customary from Congo. But we don't know that they're from Congo. You know, I didn't even know there's a city in Mississippi called Congo. Congo, Mississippi. Most of us don't even know there are pyramids in Mississippi. So it's a lot of our stuff that we don't know. But it is there. You know. Right. But it would behoove us to do that research and know the bottom, because right now the reason that I'm even here is because I'm really passionate about making Congo present. Like, it's there like a mosquito, like everybody knows, but it's kind of this silent thing around Congo, you know? So.
Well, I appreciate this, thank you.
Okay, so the last piece that we're gonna do, the piece that was slower, I was saying to him, there's a song that I know for that piece, and it says, squeeze this plant and the juice from this plant will heal you. And to me, that just tells how we were in relationship with the earth and with the plants and with life, you know, long before. Now we're returning to the whole naturopathic and all of that. But that song, which is one of my favorite, goes to one of my favorite dances, that song just says it all for me, you know, in terms of us returning to our indigenous cultures. So the next piece we're gonna do is like probably my favorite Congolese rhythm. It's Nzovi. It's a healing dance, and that's how it was first introduced to me, that it's a healing dance by Sandor. How do you say his last name?
Sandor?
Okay. Anyway. Hey! before.
So big thank you to Rima and Doc for this beautiful performance. I hope everybody's warmed up and ready for the rest of the program. We're going to follow up by the film screening, The Memories of Lumumba by Lubangi. He's going to come over and give us a bit of background on how the screening of the movie came about.
My name is Lubangi Muniania. Thank you very much for coming. We are celebrating Lumumba, the life of Lumumba, Patrice Lumumba. the film we are about to see, it was done in 1999, the closing of the last century. Because back then, the Museum for African Art, which used to be located on Broadway and Houston Street, put together an exhibition about African urban art. So some people call it popular art. It was very interesting because the tradition was putting on display traditional African art, which represented the old traditions of Africa. People were not used to seeing urban paintings and modern sculptures from Africa. So the urban paintings really came about telling a story. As you know, in Africa, storytelling was very much part of the culture. So when cities start popping from left and right due to colonization, so that tradition tended to die. So urban painters came out just like that. So they were painting stories. They were telling stories by painting. So that tradition started like in, let's say, early 60s, because the media or the newspapers were telling the stories of the colonizers. So the Africans did not see themselves on the news. If they see themselves on the news, they were running, being killed, or just screaming. So they started telling their own stories. These paintings start popping on city corners here and there. Now, Lumumba was assassinated in 1961. As a leader in Congo, he was a prime minister. He was there for only 2 months. People don't really think about it, but you think about it, 2 months only. But the impact he had in the whole country and the rest of Africa was very big. And yet, people saw the story of Patrice Lumumba on urban paintings, everywhere. Now, I think when Mobutu became president in 1965, a year after that, he made Patrice Lumumba a national hero. And then it did not please the West. They urged Mobutu to stop doing anything Lumumba. So after 66, Mobutu stopped. They said, made it about you. So he started making the whole thing about him. But yet, and then in the school curricula, Lumumba's name was wiped out. So people grew up in Congo back then. They didn't learn about Patrice Lumumba. It was like a rumor. There was a guy. He did this and that. So people did not see films or footage of Patrice Lumumba. And Mobutu got out of the power, he was kicked out actually in 1997. So think about it, you know, since the 1960s all the way to 1997. So it was just about right to have something in 1999, because for the first time, an urban painting was then put on display in a museum, because it was very much looked at as an activism movement. So Professor Juzuiki, myself, we worked on it. So I personally took footage, old footage of Lumumba, and interviews of people who knew Lumumba personally, and those who did not know Lumumba, but they heard of Lumumba. So what we did, we put it side by side, what they were telling and what Chibumba, who was the urban painter back then, painted, just to see what people remembered of Lumumba, if it was true or not. So that's what this documentary film of 20, 30 minutes or so is about. So it was made to be in conjunction with the exhibition, which is no longer around. All right, so thank you very much. After this, we'll have a little discussion and we'll try to interact with you and talk about Lumumba. Thank you very much.
Energetic, ambitious, and idealistic person with tremendous confidence in himself. And I think it's fair to say a belief that he had to be the one who led, that perhaps others did not have either his vision or his competence.
Lumumba was really a very charismatic leader because he wanted to convince not only the people but also the world as a such, the international community, to draw the attention of the international community on the flagrant violation of human rights which was prevailing in Congo by that time.
The Congolese at the time underwent a kind of colonization which was brutal in the sense that our colonizer considered us as subhuman. The natives were subhuman, and the Belgians' view of what colonizing the Congo was to kind of bring civilization to these people with the view that we would never be their equals.
And many of us had in mind images of hands cut, hands of Congolese workers being cut, feet of Congolese workers being cut. While they were collecting the DR sap.
Tango babes was a lot on a Congo, and Tuka Tosaka Mutumindo, yeah, the Lakaka.
When Belgians were in Congo, all the blacks were considered servants. The whites wanted to be carried around on our shoulders at all times. Blacks have no value in the eyes of whites. They called us monkeys all the time just because we were black.
Bamakaku, Tuka Bamakaku, Kisketu Gamu.
I arrived in Congo when I was 2, and I left when I was 11. I would say that it was probably some of the best time in my life. Because we were living so close to nature, and as I said before, and then for a kid, it's the single most fascinating thing. It's like being in a living zoo all the time. And I mean that nicely. My father was such a pacifist that I didn't have any negative experience from being there. The communities were separated. We were living, all the white people were living in one area of Kindu, and the Africans were living in what was referred to, paradoxically enough, as the Belge, which was a community on a hill a little bit away from the white community. The relationship of the Belgians with Congo was, after all, a fairly fresh one. It's not similar to South Africa in that sense, where there had been many more generations established and born there. What you have in South Africa is a very, very different kind of situation, because you have there, I mean, they were there like since the 16th century or so.
I could relate to the events in the Congo, because we were caught up in a similar situation where we've been trying to fight for our own freedom and liberation in South Africa. So I was born into a system of apartheid, which is a system of segregation, and where we were discriminated according to our color. It's been one of those moments where you grow up under a sort of slavery, where you've been brought up to believe that you're inferior. You cannot share with other people amenities in the country. And we had to fight our way out of it.
In reality, the colonization that we had in the Belgian colonies, and at the time it was Rwanda, Burundi, and us, was essentially akin to apartheid. I mean, I have, my grandfather's actually first job was to be what they called a boy, in a white man's house in Kinshasa. And at the time, in those days, he had a pass to go in the neighborhood where he worked, which was an exclusive residential white neighborhood. And you needed a pass to get in the neighborhood if you were a native. You had to show your pass to get out, and after hours, whether or not you had a pass, if you were black, you had no right to be.
The colonial time, I think the best description is in the painting that is sometimes called Colonie Belge, sometimes the Whip, that we have been enslaved by the white man, and we should be liberated from slavery. What it means, it very clearly still, I think, means for the people that if they can't make their own decisions about their own present and future, they are slaves of someone.
The low level of education at the time of independence in the Congo is certainly due to the fact that the exploitation of the resources of the region was extremely crude. There was no attempt, like in the French colonies, to assimilate the subjects, but just have them work and collect what was necessary for the industries.
They didn't even feel that we had the potential to learn, even if we were educated.
Lumumba was educated by the priests, and he is the man who loved to read. He read a lot. That's why also by reading, by also witnessing the situation by that time, he described by himself the situation, the political and economic and social stand of Congo by that time.
Given his level of education and his age, he was immensely aware. He was a man of great curiosity who tried to catch up, so to speak, culturally and intellectually, where his education was minimum. And he had a great talent for speaking to the Congolese people, even to people who were initially not disposed to be friendly towards him. He had this ability to convert.
In 1960, I was about to finish my high school, and I was following the political evolution of Congo at that time. In January 1959, we had a tremendous uprisal, and Lumumba himself was arrested and put in jail. When the Belgium rule found that it was the time to call a round table in Brussels.
He was freed from his jail and immediately flown to Brussels, where all the Congolese leaders and the Belgian leaders together were in a negotiation which resulted in the agreement that there would be independence just four months later.
My understanding of the roundtable is that it was a process that ended up into Belgium giving up the Congo, not because it wanted to, but because it had no choice.
Upon the arrival of Lumumba in Brussels, the first words pronounced by Lumumba was he wanted to see the independence of Congo to be granted right away. The immediate independence of Congo.
Et si Jésus l'a dit que lui ne peut passer par moi, nous ne peut pas.
Jesus said, no one can get to my father without me. We the Congolese cannot get to independence and autonomy without me. The result is there.
I became aware of the fact that things were not going to be the same, and became aware that things would eventually be changing. I was not quite sure how. But I remember that it was with the intent of bettering the lot of the African people.
The Belgian people and the people of Belgium, the administration of Belgium, have agreed to grant the independence, to fix the date of the independence of Congo for June 38, 1960.
Oh yes, I remember as a young teenager, I mean, it was like a celebration, unbelievable. I mean, actually, people said, the grown-ups said that even the spirits, even the dead, celebrated the day that the Congo became independent. The spirits of the ancestors celebrated that day. It was the entire country.
I remember one of the songs, it's about the independence. They're talking about our leaders, like Lumumba, Joseph Kasavubu. Independence, cha-cha, tuzwi.
Open Kwanzaa, cha-cha, tuba, tibi. And he said, we have acquired independence. We have acquired freedom.
King of Belgium, Belgium, came to celebrate that day with the Congolese people in Kinshasa. He made a very good speech recognizing the independence of Congo by the government of Belgium and also greeting all people of Congo.
When King Baudouin
arrived to give us our independence, House of Vuvu started by flattering the whites in his speech. Lumumba was angry. He went and took the microphone from him. He delivered his speech telling how Belgians had abused us and killed us.
You could feel that Patrice Lumumba, when he spoke the truth. He did not try to be as accommodating. He spoke of the suffering of the people. He spoke of how the Congolese people have been treated before, and how they suffered, and how we are going to get this independence. And therefore, the people connected with him.
Yes, I was there, and I was in the Parliament building when he made his famous speech. And of course, as is well known, that speech was in fact not supposed to be made. In other words, the head of the Belgian state, the king, made a statement, and the head of the new Congo state, Kasavubu, the president, made a statement. Both of those statements, of which Lumumba, I know, had prior knowledge in the sense that the texts were distributed, were, from his point of view, extraordinarily moderate. And the king's speech was, to some extent, rather paternalistic. Not in the mood of, we've conquered our independence. And so Lumumba decided he would just simply get up, take the podium, which sort of astonished everybody. It was completely against the decorum that had been established, and made a rather strong speech in which he spoke about the suffering of the Congolese people under colonial rule, etc. The audience in general liked it, but of course, for the Belgians there, and especially such a speech in front of the king, for them it was an incredible and unacceptable provocation.
Combattants de l'indépendance,
fighters for independence, today we are victorious. To you all, my friends, who have fought without respite at our sides, I greet you on behalf of the Congolese government. I ask you to make of today, this 30th of June, 1960, an illustrious day that will be etched forever on our hearts.
Donc vous enseignerez avec fierté la signification à vos enfants pour que ceux-ci, à leur tour, fassent connaître à leurs fils et à leurs petits-fils l'histoire glorieuse de notre lutte pour la liberté.
The speech that Lumumba gave the day of the independence was very, very great, very, very nice for the Congolese people. But not for the white people, because something happened. People used to listen to the speech. Some of the white people threw the radio, closed the turn off the TV because they didn't like it.
The Lumumba speech was certainly a shock for Belgian officials, but also I think for almost all, with very few exceptions, of Belgians being at that time in the Congo still, because it can seem bizarre, but there was really a very few people who were aware that Congolese feel really deprived of their freedom, their human dignity. The perception was that as we take care, once again, by the end of colonial period, we take care of the health, we take care of the education, we give them what was judged by that time a decent salary, they should be very happy, and that there's no problem in them. And so suddenly learning that this conviction of the civilizing mission was totally wrong, that Lumumba publicly said what people thought in private for decades, that the main problem of colonization was this non-recognition of the Congolese as human beings, and so that they don't feel being taken care of by others, that this grievance is something very strongly, very deeply inscribed in them. That was a huge shock, I would say, in both sense. First, because it was said in this official setting of the transition of power in presence of the king, etc., so it was diplomatically wrong, etc., but also because suddenly the truth was publicly said. And it seems to me that psychologically is very often the case that suddenly, if you should face the truth, and somewhere in yourself, in your subconscious, you know that it's true, the shock is huge. The people recognize to the pre-colonial cultural heroes some kind of supernatural power, and one of those is the power of the voice. And in general, in the Congolese culture, the spoken word is a very important element, because the truth, in some way, is said in a living voice and not in a written, any written form. Local memories, local political histories are publicly said and not put in writing. So it means that the human voice has a special power, in part also because human voice can in some way put in the present the ancestors' voice. So it means that in the pre-colonial histories, some of very important chiefs were said to be able to do things just by speaking. And especially as on the radio, you don't see the person, you hear the voice. And many of domestic servants were witnesses of the employers' reactions to Lumumba discourse. So suddenly, all of those elements made this conviction that Lumumba's voice was so powerful that he was able to make whites, colonialists, leave the Congo, run off of the Congo. He was able to liberate the Congo just by the unique power of his voice.
Patrice Lumumba spoke of the nation of the Congo. And not only the nation of the Congo, he took it beyond the Congo. He connected it to Africa, in fact, and then connected it to the world. We were identified with the speech when it came out the next day in the New York Times. We read every word of it. And we said, this is on the money. This is something that we can really deal with. And this is one of the reasons why a lot of people love Lumumba, because he was outspoken. And he was not afraid of consequences. God had said many years ago that men who are earnest are not afraid of consequences. And when you look at Lumumba, he was indeed the perfect person to identify with that axiom. When Lumumba went to Howard University in Washington, D.C., the premier black institution, at least as far as many of us in New York were concerned, the fact is that he pointed out to the people there that there were legends among the tribes, that many years ago our people were taken away, and one day they would return, and when they returned they would be supermen. This fascinated the African nationalists, because we were always looking for people who wanted to develop the concept of not just reparations, but also repatriation. And here was Lumumba making that offer. So you can only appreciate the fact that we would be his foremost backers. And so we started to articulate around what Lumumba was talking about, trying to tell people, this is the guy. You don't want to get into that kind of biblical, evangelical, that this is the one. But the fact is that Lumumba did come off as a tremendous hero, much larger than life. And one, a person who had a universal appeal in the African community, and even in other countries of developing peoples, they could see that this man was fighting for his people.
Lumumba was transformed in the political culture of the Congo into a redeemer of the world. Now, this move that Lumumba was universalized. It was not only someone who should bring peace, prosperity, human dignity to the Congolese people, but someone who should do it for the whole humanity. So that in some way, the future of the humanity is dependent on this Congolese but universal human being.
The place Lumumba was killed is not very well known. He was killed in Katanga region on the 17th of January 1961. Some people know where, but it's not a well-known place.
Oui, je pense que la mort de Patrick Lumumba était préméditée. Elle était planifiée.
Lumumba's death was premeditated and planned because he constituted the danger for some people's interests. What were those people's interests versus the children of Congo? That's the question.
Comprends l'interrogation?
Yeah, a gentleman who was a CIA operative making the confession that he actually had his body in the trunk and he was driving around not knowing what he's going to do with Patrice Lumumba's body. Those were revelations that I got to know about Patrice Lumumba in this country. But I can say for me as a young artist back then, those symbolisms were used of Patrice Lumumba. One identified them or associated them with icons which represented our own liberation, you know, and there's no doubt in my mind that Patrice Lumumba has been one of the people who has influenced me in particular through the works of Matulu.
Well, we talk about Lumumba, we talk about a person that almost has, I hate to use this kind of analogy, but Christ-like, image. And we deal with it because in our time, that's what he was. He was a person who actually sacrificed his life. Because in his last mission, he tells you clearly that if he sold out, he could be alive. But he said that, you know, MAGA and people in Washington or Brussels or Paris or London will write the history of Africa. Africa will be written by its peoples, you know, and it will be one of glory, you know. And so when you talk about something like that, you talk about somebody that is a paradigm for a revolutionary Pan-Africanist and African internationalism and a hero for all ages.
When Lumumba was killed, I mean, it was the time of mourning, the time of weeping. Mothers, men and women cried when we heard that Lumumba has been killed. Men and women cried. And I think that even those who were responsible for his death, they knew that the people understood that there was nothing else that could replace Lumumba as far as what he meant, what he represented for the people.
He never gave up. He never gave up. He was a great figure. And Lumumba has to be really recognized as one of the great leaders who did not fought only for the independence of Congo, but Lumumba used to believe on the human value. Human value, the same human value which has been taught by Martin Luther King, by Malcolm X. All of these leaders who used to believe really that you cannot and you can never judge a man through his the color of his skin. You have to judge him through his attitude, through his thinking, through his intelligence, not through his color of skin. And Lumumba was that kind of man. Men of principle.
Para Miami.
All right. Thank you all. I hope you guys enjoyed the documentary. So we're going to follow this by a discussion with some Lumumba scholars that are currently in Kinshasa, Congo. They're also inaugurating today the André Blouin Cultural Center in Kinshasa. And then in New York, we're going to have Lubangi and Eve Blouin, the daughter of André Blouin. For those of you who don't know André Blouin, she was an advocate for social justice and then gender and social justice. She was also a political activist that has supported many African leaders in their fight for independence. And she was the chief of protocol for Patrice Lumumba. So I'm going to invite Lubangi and Eve to come up.
We have one more. We're going to invite Mama Bibian, who is here with us. Mama Bibian is definitely from Congo, and she's also an activist who has worked with United Nations for women. As you know, in Congo, we have a serious problem in the eastern part of Congo where rape was used as a weapon of war. And so Mama Bibian here has been working with women over there. So she's been traveling and going over there. And she's also very close to the family of Patrice Lumumba. So we have Eve Blouin, the daughter of André Blouin, who worked with Patrice Lumumba, so she's here. As a matter of fact, in Kinshasa, as we speak now, I think they're closing, there is a cultural center that just opened today, which is named after André Blouin, her mother. So they will probably join us, I think, if everything goes well. So we'll see them and they'll probably ask questions and we'll ask them questions. So this is just to show how Patrice Lumumba was a true Pan-Africanist, not just by word, because we have so many Africans or just people who talk of Pan-Africanism, but they don't really live it. But here we have, you know, Eve is here. Her mother worked with Patrice Lumumba. And I can also recall the first ambassador to Sudan under Patrice Lumumba's government was originally from Senegal. So Patrice Lumumba was bigger than life, as brother Elombe Brath said. He was a man that many of us did not understand. So this will be very interactive. And I will give the mic to, we will start from left, and then to Mama Bibian. They will tell us who they are in their own words. And we'll take it from there, and it will be very interactive. So here we go.
Good night, everyone. I'm very, very honored and humbled to be here tonight. The first time I heard from the Friends of the Congo was on the 12th of March. I was given the contact for Friends of Congo by Professor Karen Bower from the University of San Francisco. I was trying, I'm still trying, to republish a book that my mother wrote, which is called My Country, Africa, The Story of the Black Personaria. The book is out of print, and I'm fighting right now to have this book republished and in order to have her legacy and memories out in this world the way it should be. So this is when I first heard of you guys, 12th of March this year. So in between, we have been back and forth with emails, and then I discovered, I was in awe to find out that you guys have created a school, a Pan-African school, after my mother. That was absolutely incredible. It was almost like a miracle, and it is a miracle. So all I want to say is how proud I am, and I'm sure Mommy is here with us tonight, of the work, the tremendous work that you have done, and I want to say thank you so much in her memory. And for her, my family, I'm the youngest of her children, she has three. I want to say thank you, congratulations. And we are going to go really far, I can feel it. Thank you.
Thank you, I think, there they are. I think that's the school back there. So it's in Kinshasa. It's probably close to midnight, so the most of the day everything happened there. Well, you know, pretty soon we'll talk to them. Okay. Mama Bibian, tell us, you're close to Lumumba's family, and then your work, and, you know, tell us how you're inspired by Lumumba, the whole spirit of Kim Mafumbe, and then you working with women.
Thank you for inviting me. I am, my name is Aningina Chefu Bibian. Chefu is my father. My father worked with Lumumba. He created the Association of Batetela in Kinshasa. And my father was a very active member of the association. And he worked with him even in the MNC, the movement Lumumba created.
The political party. Yeah.
You say?
The MNC, the Lumumba political party.
Yes, Lumumba political party. And but because of the violence and my mom didn't want him to be. To work with Lumumba as, in the party and to be political actor. And it is why he didn't go far enough to be even to be killed, because my mom was afraid of the way things were. But before my father died, but my father was a magistrate in the justice. And before he died, he asked me to look for justice for Lumumba's death. It is why, and then I promised to him that I will do my best to follow up with his dream. It is why I got involved when I felt ready that I will walk in the path of my father's dream. And meanwhile, I'm very close to, my Lumumba's children. When they came back from exile, our family received them at home. And we are now just like family. So now what I'm trying to do with Friend of the Congo, I have been with Friend of Congo since the beginning, working in this women's movement first, then now with the project, on Lumumba project. I just came back from Brussels because we are trying to put together some project about to promote Lumumba ideas and books, and it is why I just came last week, and I am honored today to share with you what you want to know about family, Lumumba family, and every information you would like to have.
Well, thank you very much, Mama Bibian. I call her Mama Bibian. It's a sign of respect in the Congolese culture. So, like she said, her name is Aningina Chefu Bibian, but we call it Mama Bibiana. It would be very interactive. I'm sure you probably heard of Lumumba. You probably met Lumumba. I don't know. Or you read Lumumba's book. So it will be very interactive. We would like to hear also from you. If you have a question or you have a memory you want to share about Lumumba, we will welcome this. So as you can see, okay, the image is gone. Back there we have someone, Kambale Musavuli, who is in Ghana. Kambale, how are you? Can we hear you? Can you say something?
Sorry.
Say that, try again. Try one more time.
We don't hear.
We didn't hear anything. It's okay. I think the volume is very low. So when they get it right, so we'd like to hear from Kambale. Who happens to be in Ghana, Accra, right now. So they also had a celebration over there. So, all right, while they're working on this, I want to go back to Eve. Mama Bibiana said how they welcomed the children of Lumumba back because, you know, since 1961, when Lumumba was killed, the whole family went to exile. So so the children came back and then your family welcomed them. Can you tell us a little bit about your relationship with your Lumumba family?
Well, we are friends. Juliana particularly, she was my witness when I got married. And this lady over there, who is behind the camera, was also. We were a whole group of friends in Paris. We were living at the time in Paris.
While they were in exile, so that's when.
Yes. And before that, they were in Egypt. Actually, it's the ambassador of Egypt who managed to take all the family out of the country. This is what happened. So then they got to Paris and they lived there for quite a while in the 13th arrondissement of Paris.
So how was it, hanging out with Juliana?
It was fun. I mean, it was fun. And Mama Pauline, you know, she was like mommy. My mother was still alive at the time. And it was very interesting because there were always very intelligent discussions going on, whether it was in their apartment or my mother's apartment. There was always a lot of people coming, discussing about the revolution, about how we can change the world and how we can make sure that everybody can feel and manifest integrity in its whole. So I think this was a very important point.
Integrity indeed. Integrity is what Lumumba stood for. One of the reasons, I think if you remember the documentary that we were watching, I think it was Elombe Brat who said it. Elombe was an activist up in Harlem, here in New York. He also worked for ABC, was a producer. He was speaking here, an African-American who was the head of Patrice Lumumba Coalition. Because I produced this documentary, I remember one of the reasons why I wanted him to be part of it, because he met Lumumba. It was at Howard University, and also when Lumumba came to United Nations, and he accompanied Lumumba to the airport. His name, the name Elombe, Lumumba gave him that name. Because in Lingala, Elombe means sort of like a very strong man. So Patrice was very shocked to see an African-American who was like really into his teaching. And he followed him everywhere. And then when they got to the airport, according to Elombe, they didn't want him to cross, I think, some lines. But somehow Patrice Lumumba was somewhere and then he saw him. He said, oh, how did you get here? He said, oh, I had to find my way in because I can't just let you fly back to Congo without hearing a last word from you. And then he said, you are a Elombe. And then he asked him, what does that mean? You know, somebody who can find, you know, can find his way in or out of things. And then he said, since that day, I become Elombe. So it was in 1960. So Elombe Bright became Elombe. Yeah. So it was very touching for me when I heard him tell that story, you know. And then he, after that, he created the Patrice Lumumba Coalition in Harlem, which welcomed Nelson Mandela when he came here for the first time. When Nelson Mandela was freed, he came to Harlem. You know, Elombe Bright was the one who did this. So to me, when I connect all these things, it touches my soul, you know. Patrice Lumumba was born today, July 2nd, 1925. And if we go back 350 years ago, July 2nd, a woman who fought the Portuguese in the Kingdom of Congo.
organized and mobilized as a, in a common front, they will be able to transform. At this moment, it may seem that it's taking too long for change to happen. But when I look at the lives lost in the struggle in the Congo, but I also see the advances, the advance of even having a new president, I'm still confident that Congolese youth, the Congolese people, will be able to do it. While the world did not think that Kabila could leave power, they were able to force a regime determined to stay. The challenge now is that the people believe that the bourgeoisie, the petit bourgeoisie, will be able to help them. But in the final analysis, the local elites betrayed the Congolese people. But they are determined to continue the fight, alongside with friends of the Congo around the world and the many nameless who continue to help us to see us succeed and renew the ideals and the vision of Patrice Lumumba in the afterlife.
Beautiful, Kambali, beautiful. I want to hear from you if you have any question. We have F. Blouin here, Aningina, Sefu, myself, Lubangi, Kambale. You know, we lost Kinshasa. I mean, Kinshasa, that's where André Blouin Center was. We saw it in the picture, but we didn't get a chance to have them speak to us. Anyone, any question? Yes, Pablo. He's a good friend of mine.
How you doing, Lubangi? And everyone right at the panel. Congo is an interesting place for me, because I learned about the Congo via the music. TPOK Jazz, Franco, Diblo Dabala. And coming to find out, in the community, in the Garifuna community, we traced our DNA and we're 30%, at least 30% Congo.
There you go.
39% Cameroon. And other West African countries.
What don't you tell people where Garifuna culture is today?
Garifuna culture is survived in Honduras.
There you go.
Via Honduras. St. Vincent and a very long history that we're constantly researching. But I was at Cuba last summer, and I seen a lot of Congolese students there studying to be medical doctors. Other than Cuba, is there another country that helps the Congo in a very dignified and humane way? And by the way, recently I learned that there were issues with the Congolese government and giving stipends to the students that were there. Do
right,
you guys know
correct.
Anything about that?
Yes. Congo has sent students because Congo has a very good relationship with Cuba. Right. Now, you know, the scholarship money comes from, actually, to be specific, it's Congo-Brazzaville. Yeah, it's Congo-Brazzaville. And recently, I think Congo-Brazzaville has economic problems, so they couldn't support their students out there in Cuba. But we've heard of that, and then it has affected all of us. You know, people are talking. I mean, we started talking, I think, last month. How we can sort of like start helping. I heard there is meetings going on around. Yeah, okay. We know about this, yes.
Can I add something to it?
Sure.
The craziest thing is when the president, I think it's Sassou
Nguesso, yeah.
When he comes to New York, he stays at a $10,000 a night hotel.
Say that again.
He stays at a $10,000 per night hotel room. So we know a lot of where the problems are coming from. President Sassou Nguesso. And he's not unique. And that's been the problem in many African countries. Congo Brazzaville produces a lot of oil, a lot of gas. And when the president comes here, the shopping list alone is probably worth $500,000. And now you hear a student stranded. Think about that. It's unconscionable.
Yeah,
that's
so
why I fully support the youth of Africa in their struggle to get rid of all these elites.
Thank you, Milton. So we're going to close this panel. So I will ask, you have a question? Okay.
Thank you. Sorry, before you close,
Ladies, I'm very interested in what you shared with us, and particularly when you talked about justice and maman?
Vivian.
When you talked about justice and carrying your father's legacy, and earlier when he introduced you, he talked about the work that you're doing with all the rapes that are happening to our sisters. So I'd like to hear a little bit more about how you are helping our sisters back home.
Yes. Yeah, I understand. Actually, I worked with several organizations, a local organization there, and we looked for some money. We created a fund, Congolese Women Fund, where we connect with an organization here, international organization, because what women need money to survive, because they have been so, as you know,
broken
lives, young children, you know, young children raped, old women raped, and we worked also with Dr. Mukwege. Yes, Mukwege we will work together, you know, to try to promote. Because I have been working with for more than 10 years, going there, talking to women, and it is how I knew, I realized that women needed support at the local level. So I had to connect them with the organization at the international level. It is how I identify leaders at the local level, and it is how I gave them, how can I call it? Visibility at the international level. And now I say, well, you are there, you can work. Myself, now I can do something else. It is what it is what I'm doing.
Well, because of timing, I'm really sorry, because we have an artist, a performer, I mean, a singer who came all the way from Germany. His name is Nkossi Konda. He's also originally from Congo, so he's gonna perform for us. And then after Nkossi Konda's performance, we have, you know, drinks and foods that we can eat, and then we can actually talk while we're eating. Eve Blouin is here, so please, I know she has so much to say. I mean, she has a lot to say. She was being, but what I'm saying, so we're not going anywhere, so while the music is being played, I mean, we are eating, we can go and talk to Eve Blouin, Mama Bibiane. It's only Kambale that we have to say good night.
Hello, Kambale.
You got a hello from Eve. So Kambale is the only one that we won't be able to talk to, because after that, Kambale has to go to bed, mon cher. You have to go in and rest a little bit.
We miss you.
Okay. All right, so thank you very much for being here. Thank you, Kambale, Musavuli. Oh, Kinshasa is... Hello, Kinshasa? Kinshasa? Salut, Kinshasa. Oh, la la.
Nice shot.
Kinshasa, salut, salut. Monsieur Kalonji, salut.
Salut.
On va parler français ou bien anglais?
Ouais,
deux heures. Na lingala français. Na batu se balouer lingala. Na retraduire. Na le balingala. Yosa koi.
Français.
Ok. Comment ça va?
Ça va bien. Ça va très bien.
Ok. Vous êtes où exactement? Where are you guys?
We are currently in Tambo Magasin.
Okay.
Kinshasa.
What does that mean?
The cultural center, the Holy Blue Culture Center.
Is that Patricia? I hear.
It is me. I'm over here translating.
Thank you very much. Why don't you say hi? Everybody's looking at you. Say hi. Wave.
Hello. We're all here.
Okay. Right here we have Eve Blouin. I don't know if you can see her. Can you see her?
Maybe if she raises her hand, we'll be able to tell. The crowd is very large.
I see. Well, we'll ask her to stand up and then you'll be able to see her. And then we also have Mama Bibian and myself. Okay. So my question is this. How did you celebrate July 2nd and at the center, André Blouin Center there?
We started the evening with a mystica, and we followed it up with traditional dancers just to tap into first our culture. But we had about 300 people that showed up today in the community, and we discussed who André Blouin was and what role she played in our history. Specifically for many of the young girls who attended, we felt that it was important for them to understand this evening that not only was she a woman that fought for Africa, but she was also somebody who saw the importance of Congo and played a central role in Lumumba becoming a prime minister to the point that she became the chief of protocol. So right after that, we also had a few poetry that was done on her name, on Lumumba, and we also gave certificates to 40 students who just graduated from the 5th André Blouin Pan-African training, which is about 12 days long. They all got their certificates. And followed that with a poem on Kimbavita, because Kimbavita also, we wanted the day of her death. So it was a pretty huge event. A lot of people were here, but what was most important is was them understanding who Lumumba was, who André Blouin was, and who Kimbavita was.
It sounds beautiful. I have a question. Jean-Marie, you're wearing a leopard hat. What does that mean? Everybody wants to know. Go ahead. Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire? Vous avez la peau de léopard sur votre tête. Qu'est-ce que ça veut dire?
Oui. Le port, pour moi, le fait d'honorer ma culture. En Afrique, ça a plusieurs significations.
I'm honoring my culture by wearing a leopard hat. In Africa, it has many meanings.
Et le léopard, c'est le symbole, ou la peau de léopard, c'est le symbole de pouvoir en Afrique.
It's a symbol of power.
Aujourd'hui, comme il s'agissait d'une soirée africaine et panafricaine, alors, il était pour nous d'obligeance de mettre une tenue africaine ou soit avoir un symbole africain.
Because it was a night of Africa and Pan-Africanism, we felt like we should have worn African attire, and so therefore also the hat. Merci beaucoup. Je vous présente Eve Blouin.
Et chez nous en Afrique, on le voit souvent chez les chefs coutumiers, ainsi de suite. Voilà.
Here we see traditional chief wearing the leopard hat. Bon, je vais vous présenter Eve Blouin, la fille d'André Blouin. Elle est ici juste à côté de moi. Vous la voyez.
Bonsoir, mes chers amis. Je m'appelle Eve. Je suis extrêmement honorée de vous voir ce soir. Et vous, Patricia, que je n'ai pas rencontrée, Kambale également.
I haven't met you
je ne sais même plus quel mot utiliser pour dire à quel point je suis totalement bouleversée du fait que vous avez eu l'initiative de faire une école avec maman. Oh.
I miss words to express my gratitude. That's what he said.
They can't hear.
Can you hear me?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay. Hello.
Can you hear me now? Okay. So, yes, I was saying that when I first spoke with Kambale in March.
Just repeating what he said before.
Can you hear me now? Okay. All right.
That's good.
In March, I could not believe what I heard about the school after mommy, after my mother, André Blouin. And the fact that also, not only it's a school in the Congo teaching the children, the all these generations about the history of our country, but also it's a Pan-African school, which was everything that mommy was dreaming about. So on her behalf, on the behalf of all my family, I want to say thank you, congratulations. I am so proud, I have no words. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I will be good. Now I am really fier. You see that there is an école où ils ont appris le Congo, il y a Manaï. Et pas simplement Manaï, mais ils ont libé à Pan-Africain. Ils ont appris beaucoup et ceux qui ont mané à la fière. Et ils ont vraiment un grand honneur. Il y a pour Yéba.
Hello, Patricia.
Mama Vivian.
Mama Vivian.
Mbote. Félicitations. Bosoko baka musala.
Merci.
Naza fier de Yabino. Génération Asika.
Merci.
Bon, tozo tika, boko tika la rotala, parce que tolingi tozoa nduliste moko azaliawa, abetela biso miziki quand même photo tosilisa soirée na biso na ndenga malam. Vraiment, merci Nabino Nyon Soto. Patricia Roy Sabino Lissousunga Nazanani. Allez. Bye bye.
Merci.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Guys, it's time for us to listen to some music from Nkossi Konda. So, and then we'll have something to eat. Thank you very, very much.
It's already like it's in the input, huh? It's on the input. Because the volume is on, but it's not on yet, right?
It's not on right now.
Okay. Here. Wait, hold on.
checked. Could you turn on the monitors here? I need it also, please, in the monitors. Just a bit more, please. Checked. I'm going to start with one of my favorite songs from Bob Marley, which is called No Woman, No Cry. Can I please have a little bit more guitars in the monitors? Said I remember when we used to sit in the government's yard in Trenchtown, observing the hypocrites as they would mingle with the good people they would meet. Good friends we've had and good friends that we have lost along the way. In this great future, you can't forget your past. So dry out your tears, I say again. No woman, no cry. Said I remember when we used to sing it in the government's yard in Trenchtown. And then Georgie would make the fire light. I smell logwood burning through the night. And we would cook cornmeal porridge, which I would gladly share with all of you. My feet is my only carriage, so I've got to push on through. But while I'm gone, honey, everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright. Took the time also to come up with a version in Lingala, which goes something like this. Baninga nanga, dozonga nanu nasima, na esika yango, tozalaki kovanda, awana kwa, nanzela ya palais du peuple. Wanako salisa bandoki ayo babo ya bisoto kende liposo bamona nakate na mokili ya lelo toko posa na bakokote. But everything's gonna be alright. Someone told me yesterday that when you show your love away, how you act as if you just don't care. You look as if you are going somewhere, but I just can't convince
myself how I couldn't live with no one else, so lonely. How I feel so lonely, but everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright. Everything's gonna be alright.
Thank you very much. Sorry, I had to work on the sound. This next song I wrote back in 1992. After the California riots, it's an original. It's called Too Hot to Sleep, and it goes something like this.
Oyaki na yo koyo kelangae, sikasi koyo yo anako kei, mobembo ya sans retour. Kabelinga ikutu pasi nandambu ya gamawa Ngai ya wanazali Undapona kola kisara Misu ya mokilie Que l'Africa abota makama yede. It is too hot to sleep. Yamba ye makasiko Nkossi ngana pleure yo mye. Hold me, shield me. A child cried to its mother. Some things are just meant to be. Smoke fills the air. People scream for justice in a world gone crazy. The proof was irrefutable. We choose to look the other way. It is too hot to sleep. It's too Natambali, natambali, mokili mopimba. Bona koluka mwasi, akokina ngai. Nalembi, nalembi, koko, koko, paluka, buyo. Tosambela, nanunga, pena, yaga, kubunga. Uyayoy, tala, tala, nganake. Uyayoy, tala, tala, mwanake. Uyayoy, tala, tala, nganake. Yambaye makasiko, kuatika kolinga. Tenga nazalina numwana moke. Nanzato go 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 go
Thank you.
Okay, d'accord. Je termine. Ah oui, d'accord. Ouais, ouais.
Oh, Bonabino, ce titre, ça s'appelle Tambula Madembe. Navandu nambeto, bongi ekoyate. Souci eboinga vraiment, na la la. Asina motema. Si yango bolingo Ozali makila na katia njoto nangai Mbule malembe Tambula malembe Tambula malembe lembe Tambula malembe Sofi bomoni maye Na matama nanga Ezalina numa yambula Ndi ma kasiere Ponana de la te Ozali makila Na kati nzoto nangai Tambula malembe Tambula malembe Tambula malembe lembe Malembe. On a vu non. I'm going to do one more, and for everyone here, it's an original. It's called "Can't Complain." Get all my strength by laying here in your arms. This love I feel, I choose to disguise. As the saying goes, and should keep on going. Next to every great man stands a woman, ma fleur rose. Tu es si belle ce soir dans mes rêves. Je te serre dans mes bras. When the wind is blowing, I hear your voice whispering softly the words I long to tell you. I am a proud man, these words don't come easily. You say you love me, therefore I can't complain. Kanaye kotambola misu efungwa ma mikolo nyoso yewana kaka basusi. Le malheur ne vient jamais seul, wana tosito yebaga kakana. Oyo ya yekolula elekaki na motema ma flame. One burning this flame will keep us warm at night. Dis-toi bien que je verse des larmes pour toi. J'ai le cœur brisé. Pardonne-moi, je voulais juste dire encore une fois que je t'appartiens. So I cannot complain. Can't complain. When the wind is blowing, I hear your voice. When the wind is blowing, I do hear your voice. And I can't complain. I can't complain. I
I cannot complain. I can't complain. I cannot complain. I can't complain.
Thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much. That was Nkossi Konda, international recording artist. This is just an acoustic he did for us. If you want his music, you can go online. You know, you can download his music with his full band. It's Nkossi, N-K-O-S-S-I, Konda, K-O-N-D-A. So you can get his music. So thank you very much. Bana Kishasa, thank you. Merci, Mingi. Kambale, merci. Thank you very much. So I'm going to give the mic back to Bibi.
All right. I hope you guys enjoy. Thank you again to Nkossi Konda for a beautiful performance. I also want to thank the Lumumba scholars in Kinshasa that stayed up late night to be here with us. And we want you guys to support the Lumumba scholars. And there's several ways of supporting them. It's either through the merchandise that the Friends of Congo are selling in the back. You can also sponsor a scholar. And there's two ways of doing that. You can either see Maurice at the desk, or you can go on congolove.com, the website, and there's more information on how you can sponsor one of these scholars. I think they have a program currently in place where they're trying to sponsor 100 scholars between now and October, where we are going to have the Congo Week. So that the goal is to have 100 scholars that are going to be sponsored. And now I guess you guys can go help yourself to the food and just talk more with some of their guests. And the dancer that was here earlier, Andosh, she's having a Fulambila Congo Dance Conference on 134th Street on July 12th to July 14th if you guys want to see her dance some more. Thank you all for being here tonight. Thank you.
It's E. Kelly.
Oh, baby. Pour me water. Holy water. When this fire. Pour me water, some holy water, make it quench this fire. Everybody want me, make I no fall in love with you. But I no answer them, I tell them, say na you. Right now you come and then you play me for a fool. I'm out here wondering, waiting I do. Yeah, baby, pour me water.